Shout to the Lord, dear, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas we roll at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. In you, my Jesus, Savior. Lord, my Savior. Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise you. You are the source of your mighty love, my comfort, my shelter. You're the tower of refuge and strength. So let every bread and all that I have never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the air let us sing. And power and majesty praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas we roll at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promises I have in you. Oh, nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you, my Jesus, my Savior. Oh, there is none like you. Oh, that I am. Let every bird and all that I am, wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my Savior. Oh, you're the tower of refuge and strength. So let every breath and all that I am never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth that is singing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Father, here we are, O God, in your presence there is joy. At your right hand side are the fullness of your grace. We want to be where you are. We want to enter and dwell the place where you are. Reveal yourself to us in Jesus' name. Please join me as we read Mark chapter 10, verse 9. Mark chapter 10. Therefore, what God have joined together, let no man separate it. Therefore, what God have joined together, let no man separate it. I mean, this scripture is a scripture that basically when we quote it, we think of marriage. What God have joined together. The disciples and the Pharisees came to Jesus Christ And they were questioning the Lord about divorce. And the Lord said, in the beginning, God make it one. God made it one. And for this reason, a law was made that the husband and wife, both of them, will leave their prospective parents, leave them behind, and come and join together. That is what Christianity is about. We need to leave our past behind and come and join to Christ, that we will be nailed together. I chose this scripture because the word of God is applicable in any area. In the early, the first subjects or the first teachings that we made on costless Christianity, that's also part two of the costless Christianity. Costless, thing that will cost us nothing. Thing that will cost us nothing. Ladies and gentlemen, to leave something behind is a cost. To leave something behind to come and cleave to another thing is a cost. It is a risk. It's faith-based thing. To leave your parents to come and cleave to a person that you might not know before is a big problem. I don't know when you met your wife, if you are married, or when you met your husband. Did you just trust that the person initially, if your mind was not on something, that I'm going to get something out of this? It depends upon what you are aiming after, that you are not afraid to take the risk. If you are aiming after something, you are not afraid to take the risk. When the Lord told me that this is your wife, I wasn't afraid at all, because I knew God will never give me anything which have trouble. And I've built my relationship with my spouse based upon what God said. I knew that God was giving me the best. The only thing that I cannot attract the best is my attitude and the way I'll treat the person. So I don't focus on how my wife behaves. I focus on how I behave. My behavior is my goal. So I do everything that I can. I do everything that I can as a husband. And I leave her to do what she can. What she can't, I don't force her. Because if I push and I force her, I'll get a fake personality. And I don't like it. I want a real person. And that is how God is searching for us. We need to live a life that will cost us, not to cost others. Our relationship with God should cost us. It shouldn't cost God. You don't hear me. You want to go to church, that pastor will lay his hands upon you. You want to go to church and be in a prayer queue. You want to go to church and we throw water on you. But they don't tell you how to live a life that will turn Satan away. Die, 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 die. But you don't want to kill your pride. You don't want to kill your ego. You don't want to kill the lifestyle that you have lived in the past, that nobody can advise you. You don't want to kill that. You're a proud person. I am afraid to use the word pride, because in the Bible, whenever we use pride, it's a dangerous thing. I'm a very proud Christian. I'm afraid to use such words. I'm afraid. Because pride is not a good word in the Bible. It might be on the streets, but when you come to Bible, pride is always identified with Satan. Jesus wasn't proudful, he was humble. Opposites. Jesus is calling you to live a costless and a costful life. You can't live a costless life in Christ. We started by saying that costless things are things without value. Things that have lost its market value. There is a shop, there is a market in the city where I live. They sell fruits. And most of the time, I can't remember one time I went and I bought a fruit. Very cheap. To be honest with you, when I brought the fruit in, I would not eat the fruit the next day, the second day. So at the end of the day, a basket of, what was it? Strawberry or this perishable fruit is spoiled just quicker. I threw all of them in the bin. I said, wow, I just wasted my £1 for nothing. It was cheap. It was cheap. When you buy things cheap, sometimes you don't need them. Have you bought something so cheap? Sometimes here in Europe, they'll do the reduction and summer sales and all these sales. They bring things that nobody wants. Sometimes £1, £2. And you begin to grab them. You go to, before you leave, that, woo, I'm spending love. Most of the time, you buy things that are other, they are smaller than your size, or you don't need them. Cheap things are not good. I don't encourage Christians to live a cheap Christianity. What have you left behind? What have you left behind? Join me as we read Hebrews chapter 11. You need to leave something behind to be able to make heaven. If you don't want to leave anything behind, I am afraid. Proverbs, Hebrews chapter 11 is a chapter that talks about faith. My teachings today is costless Christian life, cheap Christianity, valueless Christian life that costs you nothing. It's not a proper Christianity. But you want everything to go at the expense of God. Dangerous. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the promises of things that you have not heard, the evidence of things not seen, for by it the elders obtain good reward. Did you hear that? By faith, the Old Testament Christians receive a good report by faith. They did not see most of the things. They didn't live it, yet we will consider them as righteous people. Righteousness is act of belief. It's a faith. The day that you accept Jesus as your personal savior, you become born again. The day you accepted Jesus into your life, the Holy Spirit came to dwell in you. And he brought the whole nature, the righteous nature, the humble nature, the holy nature. You become sanctified. You become justified. That very day, all this package, you have them. Christianity is a package that we receive and live after. And if you have not received it, you can't live it. You can't live it. The day that we invited the Holy Spirit into our life, he baptized us with the Spirit of God. That day we started speaking in tongues. You don't believe it, therefore you don't speak it. You are not going to places where they speak. You don't follow it. Apart from the Holy Spirit in my life, apart from the Bible in my hands, apart from the blood of Jesus Christ, I lay myself in. My tongue speaking is one of the most valuable things in my Christian life. Because that is my communication line that nobody can interfere. Nobody. I am the only person that will block it with sin. By faith, we pray. By faith, we receive the gift of God. By faith, we render our life to God. Through faith, we understand that the world were formed. We just understand Genesis chapter 1. By faith, we don't know when it was formed, but we know that God formed it by the word of God. So that these which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Everything that we see here on earth come from a place. Nothing just came as it is. Somebody legislated that. Somebody allowed it to come. So we start by faith. Abel offered unto God excellent sacrifice than Cain. He gave to God. He gave a sacrifice. Let me tell you that the only thing that causes God to be happy at us is sacrifice. Christianity is sacrificial life. That is all that you're going to hear on this subject. You don't want to sacrifice anything to God. Because you don't have faith. You don't have trust. You don't have confidence. You don't value him. You don't respect him. And you don't trust him. The day that you value and trust God, you are willing to give up everything. You are willing to give up everything. Are you willing to go? By faith, Abel offered unto God a sacrifice that caught the heart of God. And he will receive a witness that he was a righteous person. The first righteous person that died. Thank be to God that the first person that died on earth was a righteous man. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Why should the second born die? Because the first born would die in his sin. But the second born would die in righteousness. Oh, you don't understand. You don't understand. You will understand me by the end of these teachings. Abel was the second born, isn't it? He died out of righteous sake. Jesus was the second born, isn't it? Adam was the first. Jesus was the last. We have only two children that were born through the DNA of God. Straight away. That mother and father DNA was not part of it. Adam and Jesus Christ. The first two sons of Adam and Eve were Cain and Abel. And the second born died out of righteous sake. He died because he sacrificed unto God. Jesus Christ died because of his sacrifices. Can you understand something here? The righteous man died because of their sacrifices. And they live for their sacrifices. If you are willing to die for Christ, by sacrificing this present life, you live for that sacrifice. Let me build it up. And Abel obtained a witness that he was a righteous man. God testified of his gifts, and by its being dead, yet speaketh. Although Abel is dead, yet his gift is still alive and it is speaking to us. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was found not, because God had translated him. Before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Enoch was another person, the first person that was raptured in the Bible, because he was a righteous person. And the next person that was raptured in the New Testament was Jesus Christ. He was raptured. Enoch also stand with Jesus Christ. Example of men that are going to be raptured. And you and me are going to be part of it. If you are willing to live a life that can transform and transfer us to heaven. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. Darling, without faith, it is impossible. To please God here means it is impossible to identify yourself with him. It is impossible to give him the glory. It is impossible that your life will bring the glory to God. You can't please God. You can't receive what he has. You can't become like him. You can't live like him. You can't reflect on God. And God is never going to be pleased. God is not going to be happy at you without faith. What are you giving unto God? A sacrifice. Costly sacrifice. Not costless. Not cheap. Not valueless. But something that catches the eye. If you and me are going to live our life for God, let it be a life that attracts other people. That somebody will look at you and say, when I look at you, I admire serving God. Have you been told like that before? That some people will come closer to you and say, well, you have everything. I don't know why you're serving God. And you let them know that this is what God desires. God is not interested on the worst, but he wants the best. He wants the best. He takes things that the world have rejected to put to shame. Things that they think that it should be the one that God should accept. It is impossible to please God. And therefore, everyone that comes to God must believe that he is God. And he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He will reward you. He will reward you. Verse 7, by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark, seven of his household, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteous which is by faith. Whenever we are talking about faith, we are talking about righteousness. Now Noah received a commandment of God to build an ark. He received a commandment of God to preserve his life and build an ark that will preserve righteous people.
Jesus Christ became a part of Noah's who built the ark that is going to save the righteous people. Anything in the Bible can be compared unto Jesus. Any righteous standard that have been set is the type of Jesus Christ. Jesus is building the church as Noah built the ark. So is Jesus building the church that will preserve the righteous. Only faithful people can be part. Noah was faithful. Noah was faithful. But then there was no rainfall. So when Noah said it's going to rain, people mocked at her. People insulted her. They gave all kinds of names. They might call him a false prophet. They must call him naive. We are living in a world where the righteous people are being considered as evil people. If you speak against sin, if you speak Bible, if you use Bible language, nobody wants to relate to you. Why? Because the world has become demonic. And Satan doesn't want to have anything in common with Christ. And those people who want to relate to the world, they can't please God. They are in conflicts. There should be a conflict between Christianity and worldliness. Oh, listen to me, darling. There should be a big difference between. There should be a gap. There should be a gap between us and unbelievers. And that is why I challenge you. If what the unbelievers are doing, if we Christians are doing, we are not Christians. They won't do what we are doing. Therefore, we shouldn't do what they are doing. The two are in conflicts all the time. They won't do what we are doing. Therefore, we shouldn't do what they are doing. A church who want to use worldliness to attract people to church. God's standard is forever. And whatsoever we use to attract people, we need to use the same thing to entertain them. If we use sin to attract people, we must use sin to entertain them. Because they will leave. They come to us because of those things. I was talking to a sister last time at a workplace. And she was telling me that their church, they are using football to bring their youth to God. I say, eh. Whatsoever you use to win the church, the people to church, you need to use them to use the same thing to keep them. I wish we use Bible. I wish we use seminar. I wish we use prayer and fasting to win souls to God. And I wish we use Christ, the presence of the Holy Spirit, to attract them so much, so well, that they see there is something in this thing that I desire. And that Christ will keep them. Not entertainment, not video shows, not television, not games. The church is a rotten place that the worldly people come and they feel comfortable. Because everything that they are doing in the world, that is in the church. They are not losing anything. How can they live a normal standard life for God if they are not losing anything? If you come to Christ and you don't lose anything, you must lose something. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out of a place which were should after receive for an inheritance, obey, and he went out not knowing where he went. That is where I'm talking to. You need to lose something. Abraham had to lose it. God said, come out. In Genesis chapter 17, come out of your kindred. Come out of your father's house. Move away from your comfort zone. Turn out. Leave that place. I'm going to a place that I will show you. Abraham left not knowing where he was going. When he told his family member, I have heard a brother say I should go. Abraham, are you of your senses? Are you normal, Abraham? Say, yes, dad. I hear your voice. And within my innermost being, I am fully convinced that that is what my life has been waiting for. Oh, my heart is satisfied. When you hear the voice of God, there should be a satisfaction in you. And when he tells you to go and lie down and die, you are willing to go because you know that you are satisfied. Why are we not hearing the satisfactory voice of God that should push us to live our standard, the standard that Christ laid for him? Abraham left not knowing where he was going. He left everything that he has acquired. He left the name. He left the family members. area of familiarity. Have you been in a big city that you don't know anybody before? That when you are driving, you don't know where you are going. And God said, go there. Have you responded to such a call? Abraham did it. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise as in the strange land. Did you hear that? He became a stranger in the land that he was not familiar. Dwelling in the tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with whom the same promises belong. For he looked for a city which had a foundation, whose builder and maker is God. His hope was in that city. He obeyed. Abraham obeyed promptly without hesitation. He said, if you send me, I will go. If you lead me, I will go. You have called me and I will answer. And if you lead, Lord, I will go. Though Sarah, through faith, Sarah herself received strength to conceive a seed and was delivered unto a child when he was past age, because she judged him faithful. Who has promised? He judged him faithful. I call you faithful. They call God faithful. Faith means having faith in God, that he is a faithful God, that what he has said, he will do it. Let me pause here and I will come back later. I will come back to verse 11. It said, through faith, Sarah, when she had passed the age of giving birth, she still believed that she can conceive and give birth. Wow. Have you given up something for God? Faith life, ladies and gentlemen, is a risk-taking life. It's a risk-taking life. Ladies and gentlemen, when we are willing to give a costive lifestyle to God, it reveals our love for Christ and our willingness to suffer for him. True love consider no labor, no cost, no sacrifice too great. True love does not consider those things as a heavy thing. When we consider the life of Jacob in Genesis chapter 29, labored for 14 years for Rachel. He loved him. He loved her so much. So he was able to live a sacrificial life. After he had fulfilled the 14 years, he told his uncle, now I'm going back. I've achieved what I've came for. Are you willing to labor? Are you willing to labor for the love of Christ? Do you love him so much that you are willing to pay every price? You are willing to do everything silly. People may call you a fanatic Christian. People may tell you you are taking your love for God too far. Oh yes. True love is always liberal and open-hearted. And when love is missing, what can men give? What can men give if the true love is missing? Ladies and gentlemen, there is nothing that can be considered as an investment, as charity, as lust, when we do it in the name of God. There is nothing that can be considered. Whatsoever we do in the name of God, we can do it as a charity. We can do it as loss. But we must do it as investment for our future soul. God so loved the world that he gave. If our love for God does not cause us to give a costive lifestyle to Christ, then we don't love him much. Have you got something to give unto God? Have you got something to show that we love him? Have you got something to show that we trust him? Sarah, have her passed her menses? Yes, she conceived and gave birth. Ladies and gentlemen, A gift that will cost me nothing, reveal lack of regard for the majesty and the glory of God. A gift, a Christian life that is not willing to give up something, to win something, is a stealing lifestyle. It's a deception. Liars! Liars! Earlier on, I was listening to a program that an armed robber went daylight and robbed people in their shop. You may ask me, how can this be? It is possible. This gentleman saw three little children walking outside and said, hey, come. He put his children in the car, went into a shop, ordered goods, expensive goods, and told the storekeeper, I'm sorry, I don't have enough money. I've just went in and I've run out of money, but I want to take your things. I want to leave one of my children here, and I will bring the money and pick my child back. He bought a goods of 3,000 Ghana cedis. Hired a taxi and told the taxi driver to go with among the three, take one with him and go and drop those stuff. His boss, he has dressed like a construction manager. So go to that building site. My boss is there. He will give you money. Go with one of my children. He don't know. He doesn't know the children anywhere. But before, he said, now let us go to another shop. When they reach another shop, he has bought building material. He bought paint here. Now he has bought some aluminium and nails and other things. He has not paid it. So the storekeeper said, but boss, you've not paid me. And he wanted to say, no, oh, sorry. Said, oh, I told you I'm going to pay you. Okay, let me leave one of my children here and I'm going to bring the money. So the taxi driver sat back. He was very intelligent. He said, no, something is wrong here. So the man said, no, I can't allow you to take it. I can't allow you to take it. So if you want to pay me, fair. If you don't want to pay me, leave it. So he said, okay, you taxi driver, take the paint, go and drop it with my child. And when you come back, I'll be finished with this one. Then we go together. So the taxi driver sat in the car, said straight away. He asked the guy, the child, do you know this man? He said, no. So something is wrong. He said, of a sudden, something fell on him that something is wrong. And coincidentally, the second shop belongs to a pastor. And I believe he was praying somewhere. So this armed robber went into the shop of a pastor. So this guy said, oh, if I want to send these items, I don't know which are the people over there who are going to kill me and take my taxi. So let me go back to the first shop and drop the items. So he went to the first shop and dropped the items. And even the storekeeper wasn't happy that he has brought the items back. We want our money. We saw the thing. Why are you bringing it back? He said, no, darling, something is fake here. The man who bought the items is a thief. He's an armed robber. He has gone to another shop to do the same thing. I have dropped it back and I want to run to arrest the guy before he runs away. So he said when he was going, he saw that this guy has maneuvered his way to put those items, the second item, into another taxi and put another boy, the boys were three, in the taxi. And everywhere they leave one. The devil is a liar. So he said, he called the taxi driver and said, stop. Where is the guy who put those items in there? And when the guy saw the first taxi coming with a top speed, passing through all the traffic with a top speed, he said, no, something is dangerous. So this armed robber smelled that something wrong is happening. So of a sudden, he jumped into another taxi and he fled. And the second taxi, which had been ordered to go into the same site and drop the items, said that he crossed him and said, where is that guy? He said, he has joined another taxi there. He's gone. He said, okay, so where are you taking these things? He said, he has told me to go and drop it. He said, did you ask him where you are going? Did he give you money? He said, no. So, and are you sure that he's going to pay the money to you? If you go and nobody is there, and somebody is going to steal your car, what are you? He said, oh, I never thought of that. So he drove, he stopped that taxi, second taxi, who was holding also the second items. Entered into the shop and said, please, that guy is an armed robber. Let's quickly rush after him. This time the pastor has come. And these little children became the center of attraction, that these children were part of that man, but they don't know him anywhere. And the pastor said, had he not been there earlier, the people have taken stones, wanted to stone these three boys and kill them. Innocent children. Daylight armed robbery is going on. Why? Lack of understanding, lack of knowledge, lack of commitment. People's life are not dedicated unto God. And Satan is willing to do everything. Somebody who have gone to bank to borrow money, to do business. Armed robbers go daylight. And they have powers to convince people. They have powers to convince people to sell items to them. Write them a receipt. One lady said even they came to her shop. They bought items and they borrowed 50 CDs on top. Oh, sister, we are run out of money and we don't have anything to eat. Please, can you give us 50? We will top it up on your money. So the item, they took it away and they took even her 50 CDs also to buy water and drank. You know what is going on in Africa? You don't want to give up anything to God and serve God sincerely and pray. You go to your shop, you eat, and all that you are doing is eating. Anytime people come, the food is in your mouth. If you are not eating, you are insulting. Have no regard for people because you think that you have money. Are you living a lifestyle and on Sunday you go to church? Sometimes when you go to people's shops, do that bow before pastors. Oh, daddy. And they come and see the customers, how they talk to them anyhow. Especially people that come to their shop which are not properly dressed. They look at their top and look at their down. Say, who is this person? And Satan killed them just like that. Are you willing to give a life that pleases God? That glorifies God? A life that brings the best of God in your life. The protection of God will be upon you. You will lack nothing. The quality and the value of our gift depend upon our legally on esteem, how we esteem God and how we respect Him. The respect that we have for God, who we receive in our life, will determine how much we are willing to go with God. He doesn't love anything. My God doesn't love anything. He loves valuable things. Things that have been dedicated unto Him. Even me. I don't want to share my wife with any person. I don't want to share my children with it. I don't want to share even my car. I don't want to share even my cup that I drink on with any person that I don't know. And do you think that Jesus wants to share your body with idolaters? Do you think that Jesus wants to share your body with fornicators? That you show your breast on the road, you don't care. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. Satan has put so many frogs in your body, in your breast, in your bum. Therefore, they look plumpy, they look attractive. The day you accept Jesus Christ and deliverance will take place, you see something will leave your body. Something will leave that which you adorn. The devil is a liar. Some of you don't know that even you are advertising your life for Satan. Some of you are not aware of it. Satan is doing so many things when he sees that you love worldliness. He will put your heart in and you are serving Satan unaware. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus has selected you and me as a gift that he is going to present to his Father. Ephesians, I think the chapter number 5 tells about that. That he is preparing the church as a bride that he is going to present to his Father. You and me are going to be that life. You and me must live a life which is sanctified, that the Father can accept it. We are a gift that Jesus is going to present to his Father. And the God demand our best. He demands our best. What a beautiful thing that a young woman who have gone to school, have her degree, and have never seen a man before, and the gentleman who fears God and loves God with all his heart will come to the father's house and say, "Daddy, I want to have your daughter as my wife." Oh, what a beautiful thing. The father is so pleased. I don't want to use the word proud. The father is so pleased with the daughter. And the father of the son is also pleased when he finds a very respectable family, a daughter. Not the one that has given birth to two. Not the one that has gone wayward, wasted her life, sleeping with everybody on the streets, giving birth without a father, responsible father. Not that one. Many of us are bastard in the house of God. Many of us have wasted our life. Have wasted our life. The Lord is saying wasted years. It may sound foolish, but he can take your wasted years and use it to glorify himself. To show the way back to others that it doesn't matter how far you have gone. I will extend the cheap parts of your time and of your life. And I give you a life which is worthy of my standard. I want you to understand when we come to Christ. When we come to Christ, our selfish causes of religion must give way to a costive Christian relationship. Ladies and gentlemen, other than that, our Christian life will become abominable in the sight of God. And God will never accept us on that day. God will never accept us on that day. There is a proverb that Jesus talked about in Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13, verse 45 to 46. Jesus gave a parable. And in the parable, he spoke about a man, a merchandise, that was looking for property. And when he found one, he covered it, went and sold all that he had, and he came and purchased that. 45 to 46, Matthew, the chapter number 13. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant who is seeking good godly pearls, who when he found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into a sea and gathered all every kind. And when it was full, they drove it at the shore, sat down, gathered the good into the vessel, and cast the bad away. What are you giving unto God? Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus said, "If anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." Matthew chapter 16, verse 24 to 26. Let a man who want to come after me take up his cross. Let a man who want to be like me, who want to be where I am. In John chapter 14, he told Philip, "Where I'm going, you cannot come. You can't come now. But when the time is given unto you, you can come." Ladies and gentlemen, the Lord is waiting on us to give something that is worth. And there is nothing that is worth, not our money, not our time, not our talent, and not our children, but our life. Everything that within us, we must give it to God. There is a story in the 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 9 to 16, talk about Elijah and the widow who didn't have anything to eat. But she said, "Prepare me a cake first before you sit down and eat." A prophet of God was running away from Jezebel. Who was Jezebel? Jezebel was the first woman that put on makeups, eyelashes, and ring. She painted her face, painted her finger. That woman is in hell now. Advising woman to turn, women to turn away, because she gave her life to Satan to use it as a model. Elijah, who was running away from Jezebel, went into the place, and there was this woman, there was this widow, who has nothing to eat. All that she had was just few meal and oil that she was going to bake bread and eat and die with her daughter, with her son. But the man of God said, "You are not to die yet. I have the best awaiting for you. You just provide me something to eat and you won't die." Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you, you won't die if you can present the best to Christ. If you can present the best to Christ, who is coming and to divide? Who is coming and to divide the sheep from the goats? He is going to separate us. He will know those who are his. Now we don't know those who are Christians. He said, let everybody say what he wants to say. Let all of them come together. Let them call my name. Let them do the miracle. Let them cast out devil in my name. But the day is coming, I will tell them, I don't know you. I pray that day will not be your day. I pray that day when Christ will separate, Matthew chapter 25. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus said, I am going to separate the two. I am going to separate the sheep from the goats on the judgment day. On the judgment day, there shall going to be separation. There shall going to be separation because God knows those who are his. He knows those who are pretending. He knows those who are claiming to be his, but they have nothing of his nature. Do you have the DNA of Christ? Do you have the mindset of Christ? You behave and talk. You will live your life like him. And every aspect of your life will resemble him. You're asking yourself, Brother Gabriel, what must I do? Not only what you must do, but know what is wrong with your life first. Because you know what you ought to do. You have done it. But you didn't see that something was wrong with your life. And therefore, you did not take it away from your life. Matthew chapter 25 verse 31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then he shall sit upon the throne of his glory. 32. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and all shall be separated them one from another, as a shepherd divide his sheep from the goats. Jesus is going to separate the sheep from the goat. He is going to separate us. Because sheep and goats cannot be in the same place together. Goats are undisciplined animals. You can't control goats. You can't tell them what to do and they will do. They want to be of themselves. They trust in their ability. They believe that what they have is enough. They don't want anybody to control them. They don't want anybody to lead them. They don't want anybody to guide them. But sheep, without a leader, they can't go anywhere. It will separate the goat from the sheep. How many times do you hearken into the voice of God? Who is leading you? The world? Your friends? Or the Holy Spirit? When I hear people, and the Holy Spirit said, I say, are you sure, sister? Are you sure? Are you sure that the Holy Spirit told you to put on makeups and eyelashes? Are you sure the Holy Spirit told you that this fingernails is not good, put on another fingernails? Are you sure? Something is wrong. Something is wrong. It is not a true Holy Spirit, basically. And the Holy Spirit said, and the Spirit of God said, what kind of Spirit of God? You blaspheme the name of God by calling demons as the Holy Spirit. Unless you repent, unless you turn away from this deception and foolishness that you know deep within you, that this is not, you know that you are fake. Prophetess, you know you are fake. The time passed, we believe in you. We believe in your lies. You fool us around. But now the Lord Jesus Christ has opened our understanding. A prophet is a person that whatever he or she says come to fulfillment. Now they are saying, this morning somebody was showing a pastor in South Africa who was praying for his church members. They were naked and put his hands upon the lamp, upon the bomb. The lady was fully naked. I don't know if that story was true. The pastor praying for his member for good marriage. Yay. You women. Oh no. Is it foolishness or madness? Or naivety? Which one of that? You don't respect yourself. You have lost sense of belonging. You have lost sense of respect. So any person, any demonic person call himself a Christian, a pastor because he had a cross on his neck and has demons around him as bodyguards. And therefore they can control your life. They are not of God. And they can't show you to where God is. Look at the way they dress. Jesus never dressed like that. Look at the thing that they demand and they ask you to do. Jesus didn't ask any of the people that came to him to do that. He lifted people from the dust and put them in a place of respect. He took people out of no place. He covered the nakedness. He didn't put people naked. So the pastor who said that, open your nakedness, for him to lie down with you, you know that he's a devil. And some of you, since you don't pray, you don't fast, you don't have protection. When you go to them, they toss you around the way they want. Their days are coming, but you are part of it. Because you're supposed to guide yourself against all these evil men. It is your responsibility. It is your responsibility. It is your responsibility. Bring yourself before God and allow God to be great in your life. Stop tossing your life here and there, because the judgment of God is coming. The judgment of God is coming. And this is how his verdict is going to be. His verdict is going to be like this. He will tell the sheep, I was hungry and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you took me home. Naked and you clothed me. Sick and you visited me at a hospital. I was in prison and you came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer thee and say unto you, Lord, when saw we thee hungry and fed you, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? When did we come to you as a stranger and brought you into our home? Naked and we covered you. Or when did we see you sick, in prison, and came after you? And then the king shall answer them and say unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, inasmuch as you did it unto one of the least of these brothers, you have done it to me. Have you seen the opposite of Christ? Have you seen the opposite of Christ being operated in our church today? You tell the goats, I was hungry, didn't feed me. The goat don't feed their people in the church. They take from them. I was naked, they didn't cover my nakedness. Goat preachers, they don't cover people's nakedness. They open their nakedness. They allow them to eat poison and they are eating the fats. They allow them to drink DDT. They allow them to drink poison, kerosene, petroleum. They are the goat preachers and you follow them. They put you into prison. They run after you. Where you are, the church that you go is spiritual prison. I've been into one church that every woman that conceive will lose the baby. Baby sacrifice. That pastor has sacrificed and is still sacrificing the babies in that church to his idols to get money and to get fame. Many have dedicated their pulpits to idols. Many have even planted or buried live human souls. Pregnant women, virgins, they planted them in their churches. People are falling under demonic influence. They call it anointing. And every day they are on the spotlight. Every day they are in the news. And when we hear them, no police can arrest them because they are gang. Some, the highest of the police officer is one of the group leader. He can arrest the people because he will break the law. They are all in the same club. They make money together. Lawyers are in, doctors are in, nurses are in it. Prison officers are in it. So even if you send them to prison, they are going to be treated as kings. They are going to be given a special place to sleep in the night. Yes, they are living well. The worldly people and the demonic people are living well here on earth. But a day is coming. The Lord and our Savior, the owner of everything, will tell them, this land, this earth was mine. You abuse it. Beloved, the countdown of rapture is at hand. It is time to cry to the Lord for his mercy. It is time to pursue his word and know his will. It is time to sit up and don't be blind and fools and foolish and to deceive ourselves. This is the time to cover ourselves. The Lord said, I was naked and you covered me. I was naked. He didn't say that you put me into nakedness. Your body is his body. Are you covering his body? Sister, your beautiful, sexy body belongs to Christ. Sin wants to put it naked. Christ say, cover me. Cover me. Remove all the dirty things that you are using to fornicate on the road. Matthew chapter 5, verse 28-29. Jesus said, do you know that any person, any man, that look at a woman and see her nakedness, had already slept with the person? Two people sleep together, not only one. That was why a woman was sent to Christ, that woman was caught in adultery. Jesus said, you are liars. Two people should be caught in adultery. Where is the other person? Jesus couldn't condemn the one. She couldn't condemn the woman. She let her go. Because they left the other person. Sister, any man that look at your nakedness, that look at how you expose yourself and lust after you, honey, you are not free. You are not free. Woman, you have a big problem. And that is why Christ is warning you. Puts your life in a position in such a way that you won't be used by the enemy to satisfy people's sinful desire. Keep your body in such a way you don't allow poverty. Now what Satan, at this end time, what Satan is using is money to bait people into idolatry. Money, they will provide you things that you need. Illuminati are going to provide you. I'm going to go that in my next teachings. If you are not ready to sacrifice, if you are not ready to live a sacrificial life, you will live a life that are hostility to God. He came to this world. He wasn't rich. He had nothing. He had no place to sleep. The people had to feed him. Yet he was the richest person. He gave it all, that you and me will give it up. And you don't want to give it up. You want to show forth. You want everybody to know that you have arrived. I am afraid you are living in contrast to the will of God. Time has come that the bishop and the pastors should not think about a church, thinking about building a bigger church, but they need to think about winning souls for Christ. How can they, since they've sold their soul to the devil? They will never come to their senses to do that. So all that they are thinking is, we want to do crusade and we don't care as people think. He said the kingdom of heaven is like a man that caught fish. He separated the one, and the one which is not good, they destroyed them. It is up to us when they come. We need to clean them up. Pastor, are you cleaning your church members? Sister, are you hearing messages that's cleaning you up? Cleaning you means taking the world out of you. Worldly thinking, worldly feeling, worldly posture, the way the worldly people do their things, and bringing Christ in you, who is the hope of glory. By faith, Abraham looked for a city that his builder and his architect and the founder or the creator of the universe. May he be your God. May you desire to give up everything in this life. May you desire to live a very expensive Christian life for Christ's sake, that many shall turn to God and be delivered through your lifestyle. May his name be glorified now and forever in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you and we bless you. I worship and I adore you, that Lord, you give us this chance to talk about your coming and what you are expected of us when you appear. You don't want us to be here, heard, get behind me, I know you not. Father, we pray that we may be known by you, and you will be known by us. As we draw closer to you, let your word enrich our hearts so much, so well, that we are willing to live at the edge to glorify your name. In Jesus' name. Beloved, maybe you are listening to me and say, Brother Gabriel, you've said something that have touched my heart so much. I'm not living that costful lifestyle. I'm living costless. I don't want to pay every price. I even hate God. I'm insulting God because God didn't create me well. I am putting on artificial hair. I am ashamed. I am ashamed of my figure. There is nothing in me that I like. I didn't know that, brother, I was hurting the heart of God. Are you like that, sister? There is nothing in your body that you like, because the world, Satan, have told you that you don't look beautiful enough unless you dress this way. You can't accept yourself, and that is the work of Satan. We will get into that part. The pride that you are paying for Satan because you don't value who you are. You don't accept what you have, and you don't respect God who made you in his image. And this is evil, and this is abominable in the sight of God. These are the reason that the wrath of God is coming, because you've drunk from his cup of wrath. It is not too late yet. You haven't had the 666. You haven't had the mark of the beast yet. So there is more chance. Pray this prayer straight for your hands and say, Jesus, save me. Jesus, deliver me. Set my soul free. Let me live the rest of my life for you. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me from my unrighteous acts and behavior. Please give me your Holy Spirit. Open my eyes, O God. Give me a new spirit and a new heart. And let me follow your commandment and your will. Let me love what you love and hate what you hate. Thank you because you love me. In Jesus' name. Father, thank you in the life of this individual who have prayed this prayer after me. I pray that, Lord, continue to reveal yourself to them. Bring them closer into deeper relationship, that they begin to value you and follow after your counsel. In Jesus' name. Darling, if you have prayed that prayer as the beginning of a relationship, it goes beyond praying. There might be some people you need to go there and apologize to them. You might have robbed some people. You need to reverse their money to them. You've lied to people. You've not restored that. You promised people you've not paid back your vows. You need to do all these things before God will accept you. You've slept with a person that you gave birth. You need to go and take that child and make you to take care of them. You put somebody in a very awkward situation. You need, we call it restitution, restore people back to where they were, where you met them. Restore them. Some of us, we need to go to prison. Some of us, we need to stop some jobs that we do. When it comes to restitution, restore the value back to what you have caused people's life to. Do you want to make heaven? You need to do that. There are more things that I can talk and I can tell you. I can't give you all that you need to know in one subject. Please follow my teachings on YouTube. My name is Pastor Gabriel Adade. Follow me on Facebook, Pastor Gabriel Adade, or Gabriel Adade on WhatsApp. Please join us. Me and my wife, Love Adade. We share messages and divine revelations and dreams, a personal one and other people's pictures and posts and other things that we share every day to motivate and to encourage you to live for God. Besides, I have my own personal Christian radio that you can listen to 24/7 on TuneIn. It's called End Time Holiness Radio UK, End Time Radio UK, End Time Radio. Join me 24/7 and you hear messages that will transform your life. When you join this radio, please stay. If you want the truth, I bet you your spirit will be fed. God bless you that you daily listen to me. There are many of brothers and sisters who listen to my tape. God bless you. And I believe this teaching is saving your life. Please, if you never reveal yourself, call me one day. My number is 0044-7804-282333, UK. Join me on Facebook and say, Brother Gabriel, I'm listening to you and you are helping me. Please let me know that my life is affecting your life powerfully. And I should continue to do what I'm doing because you are there for me and I'm there for you. It's not necessary for me to know you. Only if you want me to agree with you, if you want me to pray with you, if you want any deliverance, if you need any counseling, motivation, or anything that will inspire your Christian life to go forward. I am here for the young people who don't have fathers. I am not a father. I can't be a father. But I want to be your co-brother, that we hold hands to hands and we walk hand in hand and make heaven. That's my desire. That's why I'm here for you. Until we meet again, Father, thank you for such a great opportunity given to me to minister to my generation. That of which you have given to me, Lord, it is theirs. As people are listening to these teachings, I pray the spirits behind these teachings will jump on them. And the spirit is that he wants to know you more. My heart cry is that the rest of my life, I will live for you. If there is anything in this life that I'm searching for, it should be you alone. My heart desire is to know you more. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen.